Hello, okay, it works. So thank you very much for the invitation. FWF and IST Austria, I already had a blast today. So many interesting discussions, and there is a really fresh spirit here when you come here. You can really feel it. I really enjoyed it. So you have to be glad to be here. And I'm glad to be here and be invited and talk about blockchain to you now. Well, I first start with, let me first start how I actually ended up with blockchain and with blockchain in science. Okay, so I did my medical school in Hanover, and then I did my residency in Hanover Neuroradiology. Then I went to Heidelberg DKFZ, and I always spent a lot of time in basic medical imaging research while doing my residency. And like in 2004, I was interested in like why are there no links in the references, right, in the paper? The internet should provide links, it's not there. And so I like started to think about why is the science culture the way it is. I was interested in open science. I edited a book on the topic opening science, because I think open science is a continuous process. There's no final open science, it's a process, right? And then due to like professional and private reasons, I moved to Berlin. And this was in 2013, there was this darknet Bitcoin hype where the value really went up. And I never ordered drugs on the darknet, okay? But it got me very interested in Bitcoin. And so I went to the meetups, and there was Ethereum, and the meetups grew. And one morning I realized, wow, there are like things in these things that we call Bitcoin or blockchain that could be very interesting for science as well. And from there on, I just published a Synodo paper that I wrote together in like 20 minutes, claiming that I had like this idea and this could be like this. And then it grew into a living document, and then more and more people became interested in it. And now I founded a company. I want to organize meetups, conferences, and bring all the teams together. Teams now that are working on blockchain for science, on all different fields. Like there was even the first ICO, like this crazy crowdfunding campaign for science projects. Well, I come to that later. First, I start with a general introduction to blockchain, and then I will come to what's in for science, okay? So the blockchain revolution. Well, I start with a disclaimer. When we talk about blockchain, we do a lot of abstractions that we are not used to today to do. We rethink trusted third parties, computer databases, service providers that are so normal for us to use, and all of a sudden people come and say this needs to be decentralized for what reason, it's good now, and people say like this token even has a value and this crazy thing, Bitcoin, which is basically just like a little storage unit, all of a sudden became value, and people even say, became valuable, and people even say we question banks, we don't need banks anymore, maybe lawyers and all these things, yeah? And it's a very difficult topic. So don't be afraid or disappointed if you don't get it right the first time. It took me a long time, and I went through a long, like different approaches to understand what's blockchain, what's actually blockchain not, and all these things, okay? So I try to like plant some seeds in you now. And if you're interested, continue reading on it, Google, go to meetups, go to presentations, and then there will be all of a sudden it makes click and you understand what's blockchain, okay? And there's like blockchain is used for music industry, real estate. There was even a serious MIT publication in the MIT press saying on Thanksgiving, blockchain for turkeys, and this is not a joke. It makes sense, okay? So people apply blockchain to everything, and I have to disclaim, blockchain can't do anything that a perfectly trusted third party wouldn't be able to do, okay? But since we don't have this perfectly trusted third party, especially if it comes to monetary value and stuff, it's like asking for the Hobbesian Leviathan. We wouldn't need democracy if we would have a perfectly trusted king that we could all rely on. But we don't have it, so we have democracy, okay? So you can see blockchain as a kind of solution. Well, what's blockchain? Blockchain is a new way to look at databases. And when I'm talking about databases here, I also say it's like a service provider. Because Facebook, in a sense, is nothing else than a big database, for example, or a bank, and you do queries to this database, which is your timeline, okay? And so when I talk about database, I also mean these services. And today, they are like us that interact. Where's the laser? Well, it's above. It's like us, we interact with this database. In a blockchain world, of course, the service is running on some hardware, but there are other computers that provide cryptographic power to secure this hardware. And to apply some attributions to this service that were not there in the standard way today, in the way we look at services today. So, well, blockchain is just a chain of data blocks. It's a data structure behind Bitcoin. A data block, contains all the Bitcoin transaction and a reference to an earlier block, which contains references to a much earlier block. It's a very boring thing, actually, blockchain. But the term blockchain, it's like the term internet. Internet was an interface between networks, a standardization of computer scientists for networks to interact. But the term internet became much more than that. It became the thing that we all like refer to when we talk about internet today. So we order our stuff online, we are in the internet, we don't refer to the standards of interaction of networks anymore. So the term became much bigger, and the same happened to the term blockchain. The term blockchain nowadays doesn't refer to this stupid, boring data structure anymore. It refers to many more things. A new way to look at database that I already mentioned. And it's a way of negotiating a status in a distributed system so that the nodes in the system all agree on a certain status. And it's a cultural change in how we manage data, how we look at identities, and I'm coming to these things, computer security through cryptography and even a new economy. So a blockchain database is distributed, it's decentralized, there's no such one single point of failure where you can pull the plug and it's off. Nobody can switch off Bitcoin. People even say Bitcoin would survive an all-out nuclear war. And this database becomes immutable, unchangeable. So the database that you can't change is not very useful, right? So in day-to-day, this means immutability means that it's append only. Yeah? So you can basically see all the changes to the database. And nobody in the world, given that certain conditions are fulfilled, like 51% of the computers that support the database are honest, and nobody can change the data that was once stored in the database. You can see it's like kind of a piece of paper, like our whole society relies on the fact that we can't just like scratch something off from a piece of paper, from a contract, without leaving any traces. Yeah? So blockchain, in a way, resembles what paper means to us, the immutability of paper, in the computer world. So it would be like for a database, it would mean that we could like see the changes that were done to the database. Yeah? Nobody could like delete the changes, yeah, once it's stored in a database. Yeah? This means immutability. And a blockchain service is transparent, can be transparent, so everybody can see that you only can transfer the Bitcoins if you have the private key to your address. And everybody can look in the code and see that it's the case, right? So a service becomes provable to the outside. It's honest. Today, like we have to rely on Facebook that it doesn't put up the likes on something, right? We just rely on the third party, we rely on the banks not to change our accounts arbitrarily. In blockchain world, this wouldn't be necessary anymore because we can show, everybody can see that this is not possible. Okay, and this is another abstraction. So in the beginning, cryptography took out the middleman in communication. Like this Enigma, this was cracked by Turing, and it like shortened the Second World War in like 2 years, so thanks to Turing. And this Turing bomb, and now we have like the trust machine, the blockchain, we take out the middleman in all other kind of transactions, not just messages that we send to each other. Okay, I already mentioned the difference, to the Web 2.0 world. So what we do in Web 2.0, in Facebook, for example, we log into a service, with our username, and then we trust the service to do whatever it wants to do with us. We just trust Facebook not to put up the likes, yeah? In blockchain world, this is different. We maintain control our identity by controlling the private key that we would need to change the system, the database, a transaction in the system. We sign it, we have it in our browser, in a browser plugin, in a wallet, in a hardware wallet, or even in the Internet of Things, there are special chips that maintain the private key. And without this private key, changes to the blockchain database aren't possible with cryptographic signatures. Yeah? So blockchain is a new way of looking at our power, at our identity to change the system. Yeah? Web 2.0, a trusted third party does everything and we rely on it. In blockchain world, we basically, transactions are changes to the system. If you would say, even if there would be a blockchainified Facebook there, the like, we have to sign that there is a like. Okay, and a blockchain is a new way of looking at IT security. So in today's world, we have databases, services, data, content, business logic, all hidden behind the firewall or that protects us from the evil outside world, right? There are some ports open that we need for emails and for HTTP, and we even have a cryptographically secured connection to another island. In blockchain world, this is not necessary anymore. So the services to game theory and incentives are so secure that they can work in the complete open, in the evil outside world, without being compromised. It's not good for everything, but it's a new way of looking at IT security. But there is one problem with blockchain, and many people don't know that. Yeah? And blockchain is a distributed system. Our cell phones are a distributed system, the internet is a distributed system, and there is one thing that holds true for such systems, is that they can't be all of these things at the same time. So they can't be consistent. That means that every node knows the status of every other node, and they are consistent. It can't be highly available. What it means that it can only post-process or process a certain amount of transactions, and it can't be very, very available, that there can't be a lot of transactions be post-processed, and decentralized. So only two of these things can be realized in a distributed system. This is the Brewer triangle, the CAP theorem, and this is one of the few computer science or information theory theorems that are actually physically proven. And if you look at it, like what banks does and Facebook, or let's say a service like Dropbox, it's highly consistent, my bank accounts are right, no matter from where I check it, and it's highly available, it can process a lot of transactions, PayPal, like hundreds of thousands per hour, even millions, but banks are not decentralized. And Bitcoin is another expression of this triangle. Bitcoin is highly consistent, or other blockchain solutions, and it's decentralized, but it's not available. Available in terms it can only post-process so and so many transactions, and Bitcoin can only process 7 transactions per second. And this is not very much compared to what PayPal does or what the Visa network is doing, yeah? So this is a very interesting thing, and there are a lot of companies or projects that claim we are blockchain, but we can do full post-processing. IOTA, for example, we are fast. But they are not decentralized. It's all marketing speech. They have state channels or supernodes that are hidden in some marketing speech. Yeah? And this is a thing that is not solved yet. So blockchain, a decentralized solution is not as fast as a centralized solution, okay? Another interesting thing, Bitcoin is a self-referential system. And always in self-referential systems, something interesting happens. So we have the blockchain, and on the blockchain, there are Bitcoins, and the Bitcoins are given back to the miners that support the blockchain. It's an interesting concept. I like self-referential systems. Like the continuous thinking about the self is a self-referential system. If I say like this sentence is wrong, this can't be solved in logic, right? And it's an interesting thing how Bitcoin came to life. So it was, in the beginning, there were almost no miner. It was a thing for computer nerds. They looked into it in some crypto forums, and there was no value to it, and nobody took it serious, right? And then there were more miners, like geeks look into it. There's something into it. Bitcoin increased in value, and some people like started taking it serious. And now they are like mining, even the mining energy is an energy problem. And there are like governments like China thinking about banning Bitcoin and everything. So they take it very serious, and Bitcoin went to 10,000, and people take it very serious, yeah? So that's an interesting way. Well, to look at it. Well, blockchain is also a new economy that's happening, yeah? The so-called crypto economy. So we have these tokens on the blockchain that went ridiculously high. And then we have like these companies that release tokens for their projects with many different intrinsic blockchain tokens that are used to secure the blockchain, or tokens that claim some other value representation. And they're like this ICO, this initial coin offerings. It's like a company going public, like in an IPO, but at much earlier stages, and they collect ridiculously amount of money in hours. There are like projects, blockchain projects, that have collected in ICOs, in initial coin offerings, 10, if not hundreds of million within hours. Yeah, it went completely crazy in last year's summer. And there are a lot of unclear legal and regulatory issues that need to be solved. In Berlin, everybody is talking about doing an ICO for a dating platform for, well, they used to. Now it's like calmed down a little bit. But that's also a very interesting field. Okay, so now I'm switching to what's in for science and knowledge creation. Well, in science today, we have a lot of ground legacy structures, right? I'm not going to name them, you all know them. We have centrality, we have data repositories where we stay our data on. Somebody could pull the plug, or even Trump could say, like, I don't want to have this climate data anymore, I don't like it, okay, so let's delete it. That's not good, right? We have a lot of media breaches. We have our Word file, we submitted it, it's in a PDF that we can't reuse, and so on and so on. We have walled garden silos that are built around business models, or this, like, around these silos, business models are built, and companies need to cash out on them. We have a lot of admin efforts that came with these ground structures, and we have artificial competition in grant applications that kind of maybe maintain themselves, right? Oh, but we are doing science, okay? So I don't like these people that are so negative about it, yeah? And, well, we have ground cultures, and we have to accept that science culture and business model are deeply intervened with our society, with our people's lives. So we have to be careful about being too revolutionary and too negative. And science is important and fun, and we all know that, okay? So we should be positive, yeah? But we can look for changes, and we all have the feeling that something could be different. So I kind of organized the talk around the research cycle. And all parts of this research cycle, in theory, could take place in a blockchain system. Only the initial experiment can't take place in it. Yeah? It's a real-world blockchain interface problem. So we always have to rely on something, on some infrastructure, on the scientist to actually do what he describes that he is doing, or on an instrument to actually measure the stuff and put it into a blockchain database. And this is not solved at the moment. And I can't think that there would be Nobel Prizes to it if somebody could like prove something in an IT system about the real world, right? Okay, if we think about data acquisition in science, we could store all data in a blockchain database. Then the data acquisition would become time-stamped. It would be immutable, it would become unchangeable, so we can't change the data anymore at the end. And I already talked about the blockchain real-world interface problem. There are interesting discussions about trusted hardware, yeah, that you can actually not change a sensor. And blockchain could be a way to secure the system. But this is all research. But people are looking at it, and I had a very interesting discussion today about this. And then we would end up with blockchainified signs if we would put all data into a blockchain database. So let's look at the way we do traditional signs. We don't register the study. We don't save the analysis, open data. The only thing that surfaces is the final publication. And everything else, the scientist needs to be trusted to, like, that he has done everything as he describes in the final publication, how he has done it. And then it's this culture of this pre-registration of studies, yeah? So we force the scientist to register a study so that he can't change the processing anymore in the end, okay? And then have endpoints to accept the hypothesis, predefined endpoints, so he can't, like, do post-data acquisition changes of the endpoint. And then we have open data signs. That means, like, we not only publish a description of our study, of our data, we publish our data. But we publish our data at the end of the study. And before that, we also have to trust the scientists to, like, use the data in a certain way. In blockchainified signs, this could change. We could, like, not only post the study, how we want to post-process the data. We could store the analysis of the data, all our data, and the complete data trail, that, like, how we acquired the data during the study, in an immutable, unchangeable way. And of course, we can timestamp our final publication where we assemble everything together, right? And blockchainified signs wouldn't mean that we are always open, that as soon as we acquire a data set, we publish it to the internet and it's, like, completely open. It wouldn't mean that. It would only mean that we would have an immutable data acquisition or data trail, post-processing trail, that we can publish at some point and can prove to people that we did this in the past without being open at the very moment we acquire the data, okay? We could name this blockchainified signs, yeah? We can do our post-processing through smart contracts, so the post-processing would become unchangeable, provable to the outside. We actually post-process our data, not in an Excel function somehow that we can, like, change, but we can, like, blockchainify the post-processing and then basically prove to the outside world that we did it in this certain way. And we could name this smart evidence. Accordingly to smart contracts that are programs that run on the blockchain in an unchangeable way. We could, like, define something like smart evidence, where we put our research data into this smart evidence concept and do the post-processing in a provable, timestamped way, and then even can, like, we put our decision criteria of the study on the blockchain, and maybe even automatically it could come up that the study hypothesis would be accepted or it would be rejected. Well, this would be a way of looking at it, how we can do blockchainified science. And then we have, like, means of storing our research data in, not only in the cloud. I remember I went to the Chaos Computer Club meeting and there was this T-shirt saying there's no cloud, there's only somebody else's computer, right? And this is the way we are interacting with the cloud today. In the blockchain world, there are projects that want to establish a real cloud, a cryptographically a secured cloud. That would mean we would store the data, of course, of some hardware somewhere. It needs to be stored somewhere, but whoever provides this hardware infrastructure to storing this data has no control over the data, cannot look at it, and cannot censor it, cannot delete it. There are even projects that use blockchain tokens to assure the storage of the data, StoreJ, Filecoin, Swarm by the Ethereum project. And it's not software, it's a difficult problem, but this could mean that there's a blockchainified, incentivized permanent storage of our data that can't be deleted by, even not by Trump, who wants to get rid of the climate data. Yeah? It's storage forever. So we have the real cloud. And coming to publications, we all have today our static publications at some point at the end of a study, right? But wouldn't it be nice if we could, like, update our publication if we have more data, maybe finding some new findings? This could be dynamic publications. They can be realized today on centralized services, like the Google Doc is such an example, or Wikipedia. But we know that the service provider could technically alter the data and can change it. If we would realize this in blockchain world, this wouldn't be possible. And through our keys that we maintain in our wallet, we can basically prove that we attributed this or contributed this thing, this data to this database, to this dynamic publication. Blockchain would be a very interesting way of like doing this. So we wouldn't need to trust Wikipedia or another company not to change our data. And of course, we can realize our standard peer review and publication system on the blockchain. There are projects working on this. And we can have incentivized science route, for example. We can incentivize the peer review with some blockchain tokens, so we give away some value to people, monetary value that actually contributed to the peer review, or even reproduce the study. This is all thinkable in a way, okay? And Science Matters is a project that deals with the micro contribution, so they collect everything. It's not that we have to publish the full story in our Nature publication, because this can be a thing where some expectation and bias is introduced to a research project, right? If we would be able to, like, first publish all our data and then build a story around it, this would be a nice way of, like, rethinking the way we publish. Blockchain would be ideal to, like, assure that we can always see who contributed what. And the very exciting field is new funding mechanisms. Yeah? Well, blockchain tokens. I'm just saying this, they can be used for funding. I come back later to this. On blockchain, we could like introduce new reputation systems, how we measure reputation of a scientist, how successful is a scientist. A decentralized academic endorsement system. Think of a transparent way of calculating the impact factor. We now trust this Thomson Reuters company to calculate it in a certain way. In blockchain world, there would be a provable way how they calculated it, right? So, and with this, with all these new measurements that can be like thought of, we could like implement quickly changing funding systems, how we distribute research money. We can like, the problem with the today's system, in my viewpoint, is that you can game the system because you know how it's measured. Okay, you know that I have to have this publication in this journal to get the money. But what if in the future it's unforeseeable, it's unpredictable, and research funding company agencies would come up with new ways. Like this year, it's the amount of tweets that you have, the retweets, the downloads, like, and for this research area, we will distribute the money in this way. And so you can't adapt, and maybe scientists will result in a conduct that is best for science and not for their reputation or money-generating methods, okay? It's just like a far-out vision, right? So the thing that blockchain does here is that blockchain can easily provide units or tokens much easier than today. We would have to write contracts today. Yeah, it's a lot of work. Blockchain can do this with a very low threshold. So you can like say, I have like this micro contribution to this publication, and I want to issue a token that prevents a share on this idea. And blockchain can do that very easily. Today we would need to go to the technology transfer to write contracts, or to have another trusted third party that were doing it. Blockchain would be, oh well, and there are this first ICO for a research project, initial coin offering, this huge crowdfunding campaign. And I kind of waited for it, and then it happened. This is a team from Russia. they created a blockchain biotech ecosystem around the test for breast cancer, and they collected in the pre-sale round €800,000 for the research project. It's just a pre-sale round. I don't know where they are now at the moment. And, well, it's a kind of new crowdfunding system for a science project, yeah? And the thing is, at the moment, this is kind of a Wild West, yeah? Like ICOs are happening everywhere in the world, and even in science. People, it becomes a marketing exercise. So the more attention you have to this project, the more money you get. And we don't want to get this, we don't want to have this happen in science, right? We want to have the scientific value of a project to get the money and not the marketing exercise. So now is the time we should like think about this future funding mechanism to be structured in a way that it's most useful for science. And I just started a living document. We can all like contribute to it, and if there are more ICOs and these things become established, we should be ready to provide some guidelines to fund providers for this. Yeah, and say, see, this is the way a project should be. It should not be a marketing exercise. The more money you put on Facebook to say your token, the more money you get. This should not be the case in science. So this is a unique opportunity for us at the moment. And I think the way science funding should happen in the future is that we should not have this initial coin selling crowdfunding campaigns where millions are collected and then the people like are off to Hawaii and whatever, and or lawyers run away. It happened to a project, yeah, that collected a lot of money, Tezos, yeah, in the blog. So the lawyer ran away because of a little trick in the contract with millions. We should have continuous coin offering. So we have an idea, a crazy new idea. Today, we just use resources from other projects to like test this idea. In the future, we could like contribute tokens for this idea and create tokens very easily on the blockchain and share it with the people that like the project. And they can contribute, let's say, some Ether or Bitcoin to this project. And then you can test the idea. And the coin offering can grow with the project. You publish your results, if your idea works out, the value increases of this token. And what's different to today's crowdfunding on Kickstarter is, for example, that you can, today on Kickstarter, you crowdfund a project and then you get a t-shirt in the end, yeah? In this ICO coin blockchain world, you would be able to sell these tokens early on, yeah? So it's kind of like stocks. You can sell them. So if the project, if you invested well in the project, you like the idea, and the idea is growing, then you can sell the tokens and benefit from it, for example, yeah? Of course, there are a lot of things that we should think about here. These tokens could represent a share on a future patent application. But we don't want only applied sciences to benefit from this new funding project, from this new funding concept, yeah? And then there's the other thing that if you have negative results, which are also very valuable for research, the token value will go down. We need to find ways to incentivize also publishing negative results, right? For example, the project can be blockchain open. That means we store our data on the blockchain. And actually, Anna Genomics is doing this. So there is an ICO, a token for the research project, and they claim that we prove that our test does behave as we claim by storing it on the Bitcoin blockchain, the results. So they couldn't fake the results, okay? Yeah, and then there is another concept. It's another crazy concept. We just like go into it for fun. So anonymous publication. We are all scientists. We are like involved into a complex network, dependencies. We are in review committees. And sometimes we have a crazy idea and we are afraid of sharing it. Yeah? Today, under our name, yeah, because maybe it's too crazy, but it's good, you know, I want to share it, yeah? And today we could like post it on a blog post, but we would never ever get any money or reputation for it, yeah? People do it, but under a cryptographic pseudonym, they're happy about the comments, likes maybe, but that's it, yeah? In the future, we could think of a system that you could like publish your crazy idea anonymously and still get money for it. And you are not under the pressure that people from this review committee wouldn't like it because it's too disruptive, right? And you can still get reputation for it. And a guy actually did this. He published a paper on Zenodo under a pseudonym, under a cryptographic pseudonym, and he could always show in the future that he wrote this paper, but we don't know who he is. But if this thing, and he was afraid because he claimed that the impact factor system and all this is not good, and he was afraid about the peer pressure from his institute if he would publish this under his right name, okay? So it's not original science, it's like more meta science that he published. And I'm coming to Michael Polanyi here, who wrote that isn't good science not always a break with orthodoxy? So the problem is, how can the orthodox fairly assess it? And Max Planck says, science advances a funeral at a time. That means if all scientists die out with the old ideas, new ideas can grow. Like anonymous publications could be a way maybe to break with these things. It's just fun, right? It wasn't me who published this, yeah? And if we would have a blockchain system out, I could prove to you that it wasn't me, yeah? You have to believe me at this point, okay? So I come to the conclusion, opening science, yeah? Blockchain is certainly a point of opening science. It's a continuous process. And in the blockchain revolution, well, there are like these open science people sitting together and think about how science should be, yeah? But they can't do much impact, they can't change much because funding is not accepted, affected by this. Like if the fund is distributed in traditional ways, funding, then we can't change the system, right? But in blockchain, we have the new opportunity now to affect also science funding. And with this, we can really do changes. For sure, blockchain will play a role in science and knowledge creation. If high value transactions are at stake, important research data that might be very valuable, pharmaceutical studies, for example, we can prove in clinical trials that we have like this data acquired and didn't fake it. Or in monetary value, if monetary value is distributed. But there will always be centralized systems that do low value transactions, like publishers, data repositories. They will not be disrupted by blockchain because of the Brewer triangle that I just showed you. Yeah? That blockchain is limited in terms of the amount of transactions that it can handle. Well, we have this blockchain real-world interface problem, and we have this Brewer theorem that I just mentioned, yeah? And from the spirit that I felt here, maybe one of you will discover a black swarm that can, like, we are scientists, we can't foresee the future, right? There might be a black swarm, and we will fix this problem, and then everything will be blockchainified, right? But we don't know yet, okay? So I thank you very much for your attention. This is the living document. I have to update it with a new concept, and I have a new structure that I will put into it. This is a Blockchain for Science homepage. We have an unconference that focuses only on scientific publishing here in Vienna happening in May, and there will be a big Blockchain for Science conference in Berlin. It will be a 2-day conference, most likely in October. There will be a serious business track where we will think seriously about stuff, and there will be a serendipity track. Because all this blockchain thing came from, it was in Kreuzberg, it was in Brookline, where people like had great ideas and crazy concepts. And I want to bring this together, you know, that we have an established science track and we have the crazy things that come together. Maybe we will talk about the biggest bogus or the next biggest thing in this other track, okay? We don't know yet. Okay, thank you very much for your attention, and I'm happy to answer any questions in the chat.
Okay, thank you, Sönke. We have still some time for questions.
I read an article that was quite interesting about the ecological damage blockchain is doing. Server farms would be needed, and the amount of power required to run these systems would actually cause climate change.
That's a very good question. And you are referring to the mining that is used for the Bitcoin blockchain here. And this is a big problem. And if the value of Bitcoin goes up, the energy that will be put due to the incentive mechanism will increase. So we could run into a serious problem here. And you can't prevent people from running mining computers, even if a government wants to like not to have it. But Zyne's blockchain wouldn't need this mining. Yeah? Of course, we could use the Bitcoin blockchain to timestamp our data, and we should do it. Yeah, because it's the most immutable database that's out there in our world. But we can do all things in Zyne's without this mining. Because we have trusted third parties that we trust, like government, research institutes, that they could run these computers that maintain this database. But the difference from today's world is that these people who contribute these computers to maintain a Zyne's blockchain would have no control over whatsoever stored in the database. So they couldn't delete and they couldn't censor. Yeah?
You mentioned, or you had this one point, centralized services will coexist. Do you mean that they will coexist because if you lay all the science information open to make it like publicly available and you see the whole process from the beginning, from the experiment until the paper, would give other people the opportunity to use this data in their analysis or compare the stuff, use it in other studies, would mean that we need more centralized systems around the blockchain to get the results we are looking for in a blockchain world.
Yeah, that's right. So we could use centralized services to store our data and use a blockchain database to actually timestamp and prove that it was there. Yeah. So this would be one way of looking at it. Yeah. And the other thing is the Bohr theorem that just like decentralized systems are limited to the amount of changes that they can do per time. Okay. So other services like the amount of, when there is no value to a change, then there is like a centralized service perfect. Yeah. Okay, did I answer it? Like, so first two parts, yeah? For data storage, centralized service, no problem, you know? With respect to maybe if a government wants to censor like Trump, you know? And we can use blockchain to timestamp and prove that the data was there. And then the other thing is that we have the Bohr theorem, which limits the amount in decentralized systems. Okay.
It's a change in paradigm, in the role of things.
Yeah.
Hello, thank you for your talk. My question is, as far as I know, Bitcoin, the blockchain at this point is actually this so big that it's quite hard on your personal PC to validate it.
Yeah.
If we do blockchain everything, how large would you guess that the data storage problem is that you get?
Yeah, so validating Bitcoin is possible on my computer, but not the mining anymore because it's too difficult, yeah? And we don't want to store all the data in the blockchain. We don't do that. We only store a cryptographic representation of the data that we can actually merge. We can like store terabytes in like one little word, a representation of it. It's called hashing, yeah? So this could be stored at the Bitcoin blockchain. And then we think we have to talk about time resolution and like blockchain things if we want to like do it all. But for Zyne's, like once a day would be enough, right? Yeah? To like.
No, I have one.
Yeah.
There is.
Oh, there is.
Hi, you said that the mining will not be necessary anymore but the reason there's mining is that there's this proof of work for Bitcoin and it's needed to make sure or to kind of regulate how many transactions are going to be saved in one block. So how would you then do that, because also the mining fees and so on will be, are there to kind of protect the system from maybe spamming or spammers that would make super microtransactions but millions of them, or and all the other problems, how would you solve that then in this case if without mining?
Yeah, there are different things here. So the mining in blockchain, in Bitcoin is because it's a spam protection to the system and it's because it's completely uncontrollable. As I said, in Zyne's blockchain world, we would have trusted third parties that we could trust to provide computers that secure the blockchain, and we can build a system so that there will be no spamming to the system because we only define these 30 computers. One is at the IST, one is at the whatever government institute, can like maintain the blockchain, yeah, can verify it, yeah? The other thing, the other point that you like mentioned is the spamming the system. I could just like write thousands of data points that are meaningless to the system, and that's a good point. And this could be realized with some way of economic incentive mechanism. We could prevent it, but it wouldn't need mining after all. Or you could say like every researcher is allowed to do like 100 transactions per day. That would prevent the system from overflowing. Yeah.
Hello. Thank you for your talk. What I would hear, I'm here.
Oh yeah. So,
okay. What I would be interested in is the blockchain technology guarantees that information that I put into the system once will not be altered, that it always remains valid, as you say. But what if the information in the first place is not right? I mean, scientific results don't have to be correct, and not every scientist is interested in bringing good results. You could have fraud scientists, and that would also be maintained.
Completely right. I completely agree with you. I completely agree, and this is not solved by blockchain. And this can't be solved by blockchain. I called it like the blockchain real-world interface problem. We always have to trust something. So blockchain is not getting rid of trusted third parties. Actually, to see it on another abstract way, we have new trusted third parties, right? But what it could do is that the arbitrary manipulation later on could be prevented. Let's say we don't want to have this evil scientist who actually changes his data at home, you know? Because he wants to have the p-value under. Let's say a scientist looks biased at some raw data and then puts a description there, you know? But if he would know that the raw data is also available or and somebody could look in the future at it, he might look a little bit less biased at his data, yeah? Because he knows it's open, it's immutably stored, and these things. If you do wrong, if you put another mouse into the microscope or another antibody, no, blockchain wouldn't prevent you from this. One could think of taking a picture of it and posting it to the blockchain and all these things, yeah? Yeah, this would be possible, but we still have to trust something. This is not solved. The trust is shifted.
Yes, thank you, but I think you've answered my question, but just to also think about the funding example that you showed. Funding is fundamentally a political and a social problem and not so much a technological one. So what makes you so sure that a technological solution solves what is a very difficult political and social problem?
Yeah, so if I got your question right, you mean the mechanisms how funding is distributed. And blockchain wouldn't change this at the first place. It just gives a way to issue with a very low threshold, bulletproof tokens that could represent something, and we need to have a legal structure around it. And we can like adapt new funding systems, and we can create new funding systems based off blockchain. But if they are bad at the first place, it wouldn't change anything. So the technical solution alone only gives you that you have low threshold immutability to a token. But what this actually represents, or what kind of project you are supporting, this is not solved by this technical solution, yeah?
Okay, we have here another question.
Sorry, on the same topic, just to clarify, do you think the cost per publishing a paper, which is currently, let's say, you know, between $1,000 or $5,000 for the author that we have to pay, is that going to go up if you implement such a system, and have you...
To go up?
Yeah. Would that increase the cost of publishing for the actual people who pay it at the moment?
Yeah, so...
And by how much?
Yeah, so these are the business models of the publishers, the costs, right? And they do provide extra services like review and copy editing and everything. So the blockchain will bring this up? I don't think so. We would have a very cheap way. We can today publish our papers in the internet for free, basically. We could do that. We don't do that because of our science culture. And we could use blockchain to timestamp a publication, yeah? But this gives a new way of that we can prove that it was there. But, well, that's, yeah. So I don't, maybe we go up if we go to all, we have blockchain journals up there and the publishers are running out of money and then they increase.
Let's say we have 30 or let's say 300 trusted organizations who are running the blockchain. Why do we need a blockchain? Because in this case, we can have a database which is decentralized through the 300 trusted parties, yeah, and signatures will take care of the rest. So
that's right. We wouldn't need the blockchain as in the data structure at the chain of blocks. We wouldn't need that. I completely agree with you. And they are, but we have the perception of a distributed system, and we have computers that provide, maintain the system without actually being able to manipulate the system, and we could subsummarize this under the wider term of blockchain. A blockchain as this boring data structure in Bitcoin, we wouldn't need for that.
Adding to this question, don't you have then, in that case, the unique point of failure actually blockchain wanted to get rid of in the end? You still have with the central services and parties who organize those databases, you still have this unique, yeah, point of failure.
If you would unplug all 300 computers there, then it would be off, or 151. Then it wouldn't work anymore, yeah?
Of quantity.
yeah, this is exactly, you are right. I mean, and the blockchain servers need to run somewhere, right? And if you don't have this crazy incentive system like blockchain, that other people would overtake it because they're incentivized, then you would have new point of failures, yeah.
Good. Then I would thank again, Sönke, for giving us the talk and introducing us to the blockchain and to science. And I also want to thank the IST event team and especially Lisa for helping with the organization. Thank you.